Tonight on NewsWatch, the newest congressional class hits Washington. We go to Capitol Hill for the latest on the 113th Congress. Plus, students from Sandy Hook Elementary head back to the classroom after last month's tragic school shooting. And how a radical Islamic group is working toward Sharia law in Nigeria. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. Good evening, everyone. I'm Mark Martin. Lawmakers in the House and Senate are back to work. The 113th Congress convened today. That as many Americans are expressing frustration with Washington. John Jessup is our congressional correspondent. He joins us now from Capitol Hill. John.
Just a few shy of 535 new members, or actually members of Congress, were sworn in today, some old, some new, and they're ready to get back to work. And Mark, they have their work cut out for them.
On a bright and sunny day inside the Washington Beltway, lawmakers, old and new alike, took the oath of office.
So help you God.
And officially kicked off the start of the 113th Congress by electing their leaders. John Boehner keeps his job as Speaker of the House. While some appear hopeful, others are not, especially in light of what's on their plate and the public sentiment about politics in Washington. At a meager 18% approval rating, Americans have a sour view of lawmakers, their image hurt by the partisan bickering over the fiscal cliff. It doesn't help that the last session of Congress won the distinction of being the least productive Congress in 65 years. This morning, some on Capitol Hill started the first day at a bipartisan prayer service where the House chaplain reminded them that they are called to be servants.
That each member might fully understand who they are, what called to be, you know, someone much greater than they might be able to imagine themselves to be now, not because they've got power and not because they've got authority, but because they have servanthood.
But the parties remain deeply divided over key issues like gun control, immigration reform, jump-starting the economy, and tackling the massive $16.4 trillion debt and deficit spending.
So we have so much unfinished business from the last Congress and previous sessions of Congress. So while it's a new year with a new Congress and new faces in Congress, many of those will be facing the same old problems.
John, during the House Speaker vote, John Boehner got a little bit of a challenge. Tell us about that.
Right. Well, right before members of the House walked in for the vote, a Republican member pulled me aside and told me to expect some fireworks. Now, the way things went down, I wouldn't quite describe as fireworks. There was a slight revolt. A few members did show their disapproval of Speaker John Boehner's leadership, especially as it related to how he negotiated the fiscal cliff debate. Those members were unpleased. They wanted to see more conservative principles executed in the final deal, and of course that's not what they ended up seeing with tax rates increasing for the wealthy. And some of these members were actually those who were removed from their prime committee posts, so they had a little bit of a grudge, if you will. But in the end, Speaker Boehner won pretty handily, so the insurrection was a little bit inconsequential.
Okay, well, you mentioned new faces on the Hill. Can you tell us about the demographics of the 113th Congress?
Sure, Mark. There are 84 new members, or I should say 84 members in this freshman class of the House, 49 Democrats and 35 Republicans, 13 new senators, about half of whom have actually just moved from the House over to the Senate. Nancy Pelosi called this the most diverse Congress in the history of Congress because in the House Democratic Caucus, minorities and women actually outnumber their white male counterparts in the House Democratic Caucus. Now, religiously speaking, you have the first Hindu in Congress. You also have the first Buddhist serving in the Senate. And overall, this has become a more religiously diverse Congress than, say, about 50 years ago when about 75% of lawmakers identified themselves as Protestant.
Now, what about the partisan divide? Any chance that we're actually going to see lawmakers in Washington work together?
Well, I think most people would like to see that, but given the state of where things are and given how things played out with the fiscal cliff negotiations, and given what's in store with the upcoming debate over raising the government's legal borrowing authority or the debt ceiling next month, I just don't see how that's quite likely. You know, Americans basically delivered the status quo, re-electing a Democratic president and a divided Congress. So you have Republicans, Democrats, not just polarized, but they're deeply divided over issues. They see things from a completely different perspective, so there's not much room for middle ground. So as much as people would like to see the gridlock broken, I just don't see it. However, you know, Speaker Boehner, after being reelected as Speaker, did say in his speech that the 113th Congress was a time for lawmakers to rise to the occasion. So if we're being optimists, perhaps, but we'll have to wait and see.
Yes, we will. All right, John Jessup, thanks for your time today.
Thank you, Mark.
20 days after a gunman turned a small Connecticut town upside down, children at Sandy Hook Elementary are back in school for the first time. 400 students returned to a new school, new principal, and old desks. George Thomas has the details.
This wasn't an easy day for the Milgram family. While first grader Lauren and brother Dalton were excited about going back to school, their parents were a little uneasy.
No. I haven't gotten that far yet about not being with them. I just need to stay with them for a while.
Their lives and those of countless others were turned upside down December 14th when a gunman entered Sandy Hook Elementary School in Newtown, Connecticut, killing 20 children and 6 adults. The goal for Newtown school officials, make this a normal day as possible.
A great deal of thought and effort and volunteer work to make this as seamless as possible, to make it really look cheerful and happy.
The school is still a crime scene, so officials reopened a closed middle school in the neighboring town of Monroe. Teams of workers, including dozens of volunteers and parents, worked around the clock to modify the new school. They placed familiar desks, backpacks, and even pencils on desks to make students feel at home. The school has even been renamed Sandy Hook Elementary School.
When you return to familiarity in a situation that feels really comfortable, that will really help restore your previous beliefs and restore that worldview that might have gotten shaken up by the trauma.
As students and parents headed out to school this morning, the street between Newtown and Monroe was lined with green ribbons in a sign of support. Messages of hope and love sent in from around the world are prominently displayed in the hallways of the middle school. George Thomas, CBN News.
In other news, Secretary of State Hillary Rodham Clinton is back home after a blood clot left her in the hospital for days. Clinton was discharged from Columbia Presbyterian Hospital Wednesday evening. Yesterday was the first time the Secretary of State has been seen publicly since December 7th. The Arabic news network Al Jazeera has bought U.S. cable channel Current TV. Current TV was co-founded by former Vice President Al Gore. Al Jazeera has tried for years to reach a larger audience in the United States, but this new deal might not help them. Soon after it was confirmed, Time Warner Cable, the nation's second largest TV operator, dropped Current TV from its lineup. The new channel is scheduled to begin broadcasting this year. The Syrian civil war has killed more than 60,000 people. That's according to an estimate from the United Nations. Fighting between rebel forces and the government regime of President Bashar Assad began in March of 2011. In the summer of that year, about 1,000 were killed each month. And this past summer, that number rose to 5,000 a month. The UN Human Rights Commissioner calls the growing number of dead, quote, truly shocking. Even so, the Syrian government this week is carrying out deadly airstrikes. A lost tribe has come home to Israel, and some believe the return could be part of biblical prophecy. Chris Mitchell was at Ben Gurion Airport when more than 50 members of the tribe made history.
Their arrival was tearful and emotional.
I feel like I'm home.
I feel so excited, I feel so overwhelmed, and extremely unexplainable, you know, like deep in my heart, I feel like crying.
And this group is just the first of a long-awaited migration. Nearly 2,000 tribe members live in Israel, but 5 years ago the government stopped their return. Now, a recent decision permits all the B'nai Menashe, about 7,000, to return.
The 10 tribes may have been lost to us for many centuries, but they were never lost in terms of their identity.
Michael Freund of Shavé Israel worked for years to help bring about this moment. He believes the B'nai Menashe return fulfills biblical prophecy.
The prophet Isaiah says, Al tira ki idcha ani, fear not, for I am with you, God says. Mimizrach avi zarecha, from the east I will bring your descendants. Your descendants, these are the descendants of Israel, and they are coming back from the east. It is as if the headline of today was written by Isaiah the prophet 25 or 2600 years ago.
The Assyrian Empire exiled the tribe of Menashe almost 3,000 years ago. Although they settled in northeast India, tribe members kept their Jewish roots for more than 2,000 years. Several Christian organizations helped bring them home.
And in fact, the Hebrew prophet said when God gathered his Jewish people back from all the ends of the earth in the last days, that there would be Gentiles helping and bringing them back. God said, I'll beckon to the Gentiles. And so we have this invitation from God himself to be involved in this Aliyah.
Another nearly 300 are scheduled to arrive in January, with thousands more yet to come. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Ben Gurion Airport, Tel Aviv.
Coming up, it's that time of the year again. Why the flu is hitting especially hard.
It's probably something I've had for many years, and every year the PSA would be a little higher. I just kept kind of ignoring it. You know, one of those guy things. It'll go away. It'll go away. Finally, one day, Janet says, you're going to the doctor. They did a blood test. My PSA was 14. I needed to get a second opinion, so we contacted Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com.
The really great thing is that you just go online, and if you have prostate or lung cancer or whatever, you can see what their survival rates are.
You can also check for participating insurance plans. Cancer Treatment Centers of America is different. You feel it the moment you call or walk into one of our hospitals. It's state-of-the-art medicine, unique treatment options, and a level of compassion that cannot be copied. Why? Our people. People who give you not only their expertise, but their humanity and the most thoughtful, well-organized, patient-centered care you'll find anywhere.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America go way beyond what normal hospitals do. I knew that they had the technology to take care of my cancer. It's a device called Calypso.
Calypso is GPS for the prostate. We're able to get four-dimensional, real-time tracking of prostate movement during radiation treatment.
It eliminates a lot of my side effects. It makes sense. It just makes sense. I own a deli. I'm back at work. My customers come in and say, gosh, you look good. And some of them say I look better now than I did before I left. I didn't expect to learn a lesson about how to treat people by being in a hospital. You can tell when somebody really cares.
Every minute counts when you're fighting complex or advanced stage cancer. So please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Flu season is in full swing, and this year's flu shot doesn't seem to be enough to protect people from the virus. According to the World Health Organization, there's been more flu in the last couple of weeks than at the worst point last year.
They just ache all over. They have fevers, they are congested, they have coughs. There's a lot of people who have these same sort of symptoms we see, you know, all throughout the day and all throughout the night.
And for those who got the flu shot and are still coming down with the flu, experts say some people don't respond to the vaccine and some people just aren't fully protected. But doctors say it's still important to get the shot. They say your symptoms may not be as severe if you've been vaccinated. The Centers for Disease Control says the norovirus may be the culprit behind terrible outbreaks on two recent cruises. More than 400 passengers were sickened on those Caribbean vacations. The CDC says millions of people will be infected by the norovirus this winter. Right now, we are at peak season for the highly contagious stomach bug. Lori Johnson shows us what we can do to protect ourselves.
The norovirus is transmitted on objects, not in the air. But it's robust, living up to 2 weeks on hard surfaces and up to 2 months in cold water. It causes vomiting, diarrhea, and stomach cramps that last about 2 days. The norovirus can spread like wildfire in crowded places like schools or confined areas like cruise ships. It's one of the leading causes of food poisoning, transmitted most often by eating salad food, raw oysters, or when any food comes in contact with contaminated hands or countertops.
Between 12 and 72 hours will be the incubation period. And that makes it tough to figure out what it was that you ate that got you sick. You can usually do a little investigative work talking to your friends about if you both had the same meal and they got sick, you can trace it back to that.
Although a whopping 1 in 15 people gets the norovirus, it's usually not very serious. But the diarrhea and vomiting it causes can sometimes lead to severe dehydration, so make sure to drink plenty of water. Keeping your hands clean is the best way to avoid getting the norovirus. Also, carefully wash your raw food, disinfect surfaces with diluted bleach or a cleaner that contains bleach, and immediately wash and machine dry clothes that may have been infected. Lori Johnson, CBN News.
Surprising new information on weight and mortality. A study in this week's Journal of the American Medical Association says people who are overweight but not obese may live longer than those who are a normal weight. Many experts disagree, but the study's findings come from a review of research papers covering nearly 3 million people.
Sometimes that surprises people, but they really should not be too surprised, because in our categories of these 97 studies, 80% of them showed that there was lower mortality in overweight than in normal weight people.
Researchers say this could be because overweight people get better medical care. The study also found that obesity, however, was associated with higher mortality rates. Up next, Christians targeted by terrorists. See who's behind an ongoing wave of deadly attacks.
White hot pain, I wanna cry. Is there anything I can try?
Why, yes. Introducing Strut Soul Angels, the human shock absorber that helps alleviate foot pain.
The first 10 steps in the morning to the bathroom were excruciating. Within 3 days after I put struts on, it's been such a relief.
Slipped it on and almost immediately I felt a support, kind of like a pillow underneath my arches.
The Strut Soul Angel provides a great amount of relief and support throughout the course of the day, providing shock absorption and relief of pain.
On your feet without proper support can be painful. Strut Soul Angels promotes better balance, control, and body alignment. Standing in your heels all day is painful, but slip on struts and you'll enjoy comfort and support 24/7. Struts is so versatile, you'll wear them in every shoe you own, even barefoot.
I'm on my feet all the time. I teach 11 and 12 year olds. The pain was so much that I knew I had to do something. And with the struts, I can do my job and enjoy my job.
I usually am on my feet from 8 to 12 hours a day. When I wear my struts, it's like giving my feet a hug all day.
It's life changing. I wear them from the minute I get up to the minute I go to bed.
Why pay $400 for custom orthotics?
Now get Strut Soul Angels for just $10. You also get Miracle Foot Repair Cream, absolutely free. Use it to help relieve dry, callous feet overnight. But wait, call right now and we'll double the offer free. Just pay separate processing and handling. Plus, you get a 100% money-back guarantee. If not completely delighted, send it back. But keep the foot cream as our gift just for trying. You get it all, a $70 value for just $10.
Oh, yes! Love my struts, the best thing since sliced bread. They heal pain from toes to head. Get yours now, your doctor said.
struts. Be nice to your feet. Call now.
Call 1-800-787-1580 and get your struts and miracle foot repair for just $10, and we'll double the offer. That's 1-800-787-1580 or visit getstruts.com.
The U.S. State Department is considering whether to label the radical Nigerian Islamist sect Boko Haram as a terrorist organization. So far, the department says it's not ready to. The group is blamed, however, for killing nearly 800 people in 2012 alone, according to the Associated Press. The Christian Association of Nigerian Americans wants the U.S. to call Boko Haram terrorists. They say that could help end international funding and support for the group. The State Department says it designated some Boko Haram leaders as terrorists last year, but has not decided if labeling the group that way is the most effective way to deal with it. The Al-Qaeda-linked fighters have declared war on Nigeria's Christians, carrying out multiple attacks on Christian homes and churches, including a devastating car bomb on Christmas Day 1 year ago. And there have been calls for revenge, but also forgiveness. Here again is George Thomas.
It was a beautiful day. We came to church to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. People started coming as early as 6 in the morning. It was going to be a joyous occasion.
God! God! God!
But it never turned out that way. A suicide bomber in a vehicle packed with explosives drove up this busy street and stopped in front of the church. Uche Bonaventure and his 17-month-old son had just walked out the church front doors when the bomb exploded.
The explosion threw me back and my son was hurled across the other side. Around me, I could see bodies on fire.
Within minutes, husbands became widowers, wives became widows, children became orphans, and parents were childless.
The suicide bomber knew precisely when to strike. It was shortly after 8 o'clock that Christmas morning, as one service was just concluding and the next one was about to begin.
26 of the 44 people who died that day attended St. Teresa's Church.
The people who carried out this attack are under the influence of the devil. They have only evil in their heart and they want to divide us.
The radical Muslim group Boko Haram claimed responsibility for this and several more attacks in other parts of Nigeria that Christmas Day. Boko Haram's goal is to turn Africa's most populous nation into an Islamic country.
I am very angry at them. We didn't do anything to deserve this, but if they are trying to get me to respond out of anger, I will not.
He and his son spent several weeks in the hospital recovering from third-degree burns. Today, you'll find him and his family praying for their attackers.
I want God to touch their hearts so that they will know that what they are doing is not good.
A sentiment echoed in Father Achi's sermons about the importance of forgiveness.
I have personally forgiven them, but what I need from Boko Haram is that they should repent and stop doing this evil work and confess.
That, however, isn't likely to happen anytime soon. 200 miles north of St. Teresa's Church, Esther Garba.
So many people love my husband. He loved to share the gospel with others.
Isaac Kuri.
They would not let me see my father's body. He was beyond recognition.
Margaret Frames.
He was shot in the mouth, in the elbow, and in the back.
And Salamatu Joshua.
I am asking God to bring peace to our city.
A blanketing northern Nigeria's most important city of Kano with prayer. On January 20th, 26 days after the Christmas Day massacre, Boko Haram killed 185 people in a string of coordinated attacks in Kano. It was the group's deadliest strike to date. Among the dead were the loved ones of these Christian families.
I can't do anything to bring my husband back. All I can do is trust in God. The Bible says we should love our enemies and pray for them.
A Boko Haram spokesman has declared war on Nigeria's government, the security services, and the country's Christians. In a video released online, he says, I enjoy killing anyone that God commands me to kill, the way I enjoy killing chickens and rams. Nigeria is evenly split between Christians in the south and Muslims in the north. Kano is overwhelmingly Muslim. Extremist groups routinely use this city and the surrounding areas as a base of operation.
It is very difficult to share the gospel here in the extreme northern parts of Nigeria.
Joshua works quietly as an evangelist in northern Nigeria. CBN News agreed to conceal his identity to protect him. He says the indigenous people consider Christians here as invaders and members of a Western religion.
I was born and raised here. I'm part of the North, yet because I'm a Christian, I am viewed and treated as a second, third, or fourth class citizen.
And now he fears Boko Haram is trying to spark a religious war by provoking Christians into attacking Muslims. Some Christian neighborhoods are taking measures to defend themselves. Others rely on God for protection and take comfort in His word.
Even when I walk through the dark valley of death, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me.
George Thomas, CBN News, Kano, Nigeria.
Boy, some prayer warriors there. Well, up next, how a pair of 5-year-old twins saved their mother's life.
Listen up for an amazing offer that can change the way you hear.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. Can you repeat that?
Frustrated with your hearing?
What did he say?
Well, hear better now. Introducing the fully rechargeable MSA30X, a revolutionary device that features the latest microsound amplification technology that can barely be seen. Independently tested to help you hear up to 30 times better. It turns ordinary hearing into extraordinary hearing. MSA30X works by capturing and amplifying sound waves. Yet it's lightweight, ergo-acoustic. Acoustic design is discreet. It form fits in and around either ear.
I forget I'm even wearing it.
And MSA30X is powerful. Hear clearly in restaurants. Never miss another word on TV or at the movies.
My wife complains that I have the volume up on the TV too loud.
And I didn't want to be in the same room with him.
Now I can hear everything clearly.
Simply adjust the volume as you desire. Other units use so many batteries, and they're difficult to change. But MSA30X is completely rechargeable. Simply plug it into the wall.
I tried other devices that had batteries, but they were always such a pain to change and so costly. But this is rechargeable, so I figure I save hundreds a year.
Not hearing the way you should? Don't settle for bulky sound amplifiers that can cost hundreds when you can try MSA30X for just $39.95. But wait, in this special TV offer, we'll cut the price in half. Did you hear that? In half. It's the MSA30X Hear Better Now offer. For a limited time, just $19.95. And it's backed by a money-back guarantee. As an extra bonus with your charging base, we'll also include a cleaning brush and 5 soft comfort tips. The MSA30X Hear Better Now offer. Just $19.95.
All I can say is just try it. It could change your life.
Call or go online today.
To order the MSA30X sound amplifier, call 1-800-920-1526. That's 1-800-920-1526 or go to buymsa30x.com. Call now.
A New York mother is alive today thanks to the quick thinking of her 5-year-old daughter.
Were you worried about your mom? How come? Where was she?
On the kitchen floor.
Suzanne Abano was working at the stove when she suddenly collapsed. And that's when one of her twin daughters jumped into action, immediately calling her grandmother to help.
I was just so proud that my granddaughter was able to call me. And she says, Grandma, our address is, and she told us the address.
It could have been much worse for the girls, could have been much worse for Mom. Could have been a real tragedy.
They're my life.
Next round, Chaplin.
My life.
Wow, some sharp 5-year-olds there. Well, Anna admits that she and her twin daughters had not been feeling well for a couple of days. Turns out that their illness was caused by carbon monoxide poisoning. Scary stuff, but fortunately a good ending. That's all for this edition of NewsWatch. Thanks for watching. Have a great night.